Tripping on acid, magic mushrooms, or DMT may not sound like a conventional therapy session, but there's a psychedelic revolution going on in the world of mental health treatment. After decades of legal restriction, drugs like psilocybin and LSD are being studied as treatments for depression, addiction, and eating disorders. And they're getting incredible results. I'm JS Rafaeli. I've spent years writing about drugs, why people take them, and why our governments chose to declare war on them. We make a lot of films advice about drugs, but in this show, I get to dig a bit deeper. I get to talk to fellow expert drug nerds about their research into the crazy world of mind-altering substances. David Nutt is a professor of neuropsychopharmacology, and in 2009, he was actually fired as the UK government's chief drugs advisor for publicly stating that LSD and ecstasy are less dangerous than alcohol. But now, David is leading groundbreaking studies into the healing potential of magic mushrooms, and his research into psychedelic therapies may just save the world from the mental health crisis we're in today. All right, David, thank you so much for joining us. So when people think about drugs like LSD and magic mushrooms, they tend to think about like hippies, Pink Floyd, and rave culture. Mm-hmm. But you're exploring these as mental health treatments. Can you just tell us like how that works? Like, what does this treatment look like?
Well, the treatment looks like a combination of a medicine and psychotherapy. In fact, we call it psychedelic assisted psychotherapy or psychotherapy assisted psychedelic treatment. And we believe, although we can't absolutely prove that yet, that the two together is what give it its greatest and most powerful impact. But over the last 15 years, we have been researching a whole range of different psychedelic drugs, such as psilocybin, LSD, DMT, 5-methoxy-DMT. They all share the common characteristic or the common pharmacology. They're all serotonin-acting drugs. They work on a serotonin receptor called the 5-HT, 5-hydroxytryptamine. 2A receptor.
And so what is this, like somebody takes a dose of one of these medicines and then they have a process of psychotherapy while they're under the influence of that?
With psychedelics, our experience is that people's mental changes are so profound that they either can't or won't engage in a dialogue with the therapist. In fact, they often become a bit irritated when the therapist starts to talk to them because they're often going somewhere which is where they've never been before, you know, sometimes good, sometimes bad, but they don't want to be disturbed because they're making sense of things that they haven't made sense of before. So with psychedelics like psilocybin and DMT, LSD, etc., the psychotherapy is done afterwards, the day afterwards, in what we call an integration session, where people talk about their experiences in the trip, and then the therapist help make sense of it.
But when they are under the influence, when they are undergoing the psychedelic part of this process, there are guides with them.
That reassurance allows people to go much deeper into the trips than they perhaps would dare to go if they were by themselves.
And what's going on in the brain throughout this? Like, how does this therapeutic process differ from a traditional antidepressant, like say an SSRI?
So the way we've developed psychedelic psychotherapy is this. The patient is screened to make sure they're eligible, to make sure they don't have any conditions which could be made worse by the psychedelic treatment, to make sure that they don't want any drugs which could block the effects, etc. Then the day before the treatment, they come in to the clinic and they have an educational session with what we call the guides, the therapists. In our case, there's two of them. And then they're taught about what might happen, how to deal with any negative experiences, how long it's going to last. Then the next day they come in for the treatment session itself. And there they are given the drug, the medicine, you know, in a setting where we've tried to make it as pleasant and as warm and as comforting and as secure as possible. It's a single room that is kitted out with gentle lighting to be as reassuring and comforting as possible. They have music playing, and they usually listen to through earphones, and then they basically lie back on a bed and let things happen. And the two guys are there. They don't interact, but they are there if someone wants to talk. Sometimes people do, but mostly they don't. And then it's the next day when they come back and see the therapist again that the real psychotherapy is done. And that we call that the integration session. And then they talk for a couple of hours about the experiences, the memories, the feelings, the thoughts they had. And the therapist helped them make sense of how that explains their disorder, their depression, and how it might also help them reframe their attitude to it and come up with new solutions and new ways of thinking to essentially liberate themselves from the depression, but also stay liberated. But we think these drugs work in a fundamentally different way to SSRIs. The way SSRIs work is that they enhance a neurochemical called serotonin in a part of the brain called the limbic system, which is where the stress response is regulated. And what they do is they dampen down the stress response. So SSRIs, the analogy I use is that it's like putting a broken leg into plaster. You set the bone and the bone heals. SSRIs protect the brain from stress and the brain heals. Now, psychedelics work almost immediately. They disrupt the brain processes of thinking, and particularly thinking the repetitive, ruminative thoughts that people with, say, depression have. And if you disrupt those, then you're no longer thinking depressed thoughts, because that's where the depressed thoughts are encoded. So people can get out of the depression really quickly.
Is it a fair understanding that sort of with many traditional antidepressants, it's almost thought about, or at least the way we think about it, is that it's sort of the molecule doing the work, right? It's the drug that does the work.
Yes.
Whereas in these sort of therapeutic processes, it's like the patient sort of almost does the work on themselves, and the psychedelic medicine just puts them in a place where they can do that.
That's quite a good way of picturing it. But again, I would like to emphasize that I think there is value in having a therapist with you. The patient might be doing the work themselves, but we think the therapist can help them kind of do the right kind of work in the right direction. Because often there's a puzzlement and often amazement and confusion with the patients when they come out of the trip, because they've understood things in a different way, and they frame what they've experienced in a very positive way. Because the great thing about psychedelic therapy is it doesn't only give you insights into what might be the causes of your depression, for instance, but it also helps you come up with alternative explanations and alternative scenarios. We like to call it new solutions to old problems. And so the mind opening that you get with psychedelics can give you a new way of framing your life and behaving and thinking, which can be, you know, essentially depression free.
And you recently concluded a pretty serious study with psilocybin, right? Can you just like tell us a bit about like that particular one that you just finished and kind of the kind of results that you were getting there?
So psilocybin is the active ingredient in magic mushrooms. And it's what we call a prodrug. And when it gets into the body, it's broken down in the body to something called psilocin. And psilocin is the active ingredient of psilocybin. That's what stimulates the receptor. So we've done two clinical research studies with psilocybin. The first was in resistant depression, where we gave a single big dose, 25 milligram dose, a trip, to people who'd failed on antidepressants. Many had failed on 10 or more and had also failed on CBT. And we found it had a very powerful immediate antidepressant effect. But for the majority of people, after 4 to 6 weeks, the depression was creeping back. So this trial we just finished was a trial which differed from the first one in two ways. The first way it changed, it was different, was that we gave two doses. We gave one dose, and then 3 weeks later, we gave another dose to see if we could prolong therapeutic benefit. And the second difference was that we did a head-to-head comparison with an SSRI, escitalopram. And what we found was, I mean, what we had predicted, that psilocybin works very fast, and the effects continue. And the second dose didn't magnify very much the effects, but they may well have prolonged it. And we're still waiting to collect the 6-month data to see if there was a longer benefit than the one dose.
Are there other trials that you're keeping your eye on going on in the world right now? Or like what other developments in the field are you like, are you super excited about?
Well, I'm quite excited about what we're doing next. So we're doing psilocybin, a 25 milligram dose a couple of times in people with anorexia nervosa. And we're teeing up to do actually a psilocybin treatment in both people with OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder, and people with chronic pain syndromes. And you might say, well, what's all that got to do with depression? And the answer is that these are all disorders in which people get locked into thinking. We think that psychedelic psilocybin, by perturbing the brain processes of rumination, can help them potentially liberate them from those disorders.
So aside from depression and treatment-resistant depression, what are some of the other conditions that people are hoping to treat with these type of medicines?
There have been two open trials, so where the doctor and the patient all knew they were getting the psilocybin treatment, one in tobacco addiction and one in alcohol addiction. And in both of those, there was a very profound benefit in terms of people being able to quit smoking or cut down their drinking. And the smoking experiment was done by Matt Johnson in Johns Hopkins University. And it was remarkable. He got like 3/4 of his smokers stopped smoking completely. Yeah, a kind of unprecedented efficacy in quitting smoking. Nothing has ever come close to being as powerful as that.
That is hugely fascinating, especially thinking about using LSD or psilocybin as a way out of depression. It sort of turns the whole idea of what we think of about drugs and dangerous drugs on its head, right?
Well, it does, but of course, all it does is put it back to where it was back in the 1950s and 60s when LSD and psilocybin were being widely used as research tools in psychotherapy for major mental illnesses. The reason these drugs got banned wasn't to do with their harm or their dangerousness. It was to do with the fact that the American government was waging a war on drugs because Nixon wanted to get elected. I mean, and they just got sucked. It's just collateral damage in the war on drugs. And of course, the damage actually has been largely to patients who've been denied access for the last 50 years. I mean, LSD was the big breakthrough. When Albert Hoffman discovered that LSD had this profound effect on him, he persuaded his company, Sandoz, to make it available for mostly psychiatric researchers. And about 1,000 researchers around the world were provided with LSD. The US government funded over 130 different studies, ranging from depression, anxiety, through to addiction. But we haven't used it in 50 years. Why not? Well, because some, you know, Grateful Dead used it and Timothy Leary used it. And people started to worry that LSD would change the way the Americans viewed war. And that was, they didn't want that. So they basically banned the drug because they couldn't stop these people doing other things. And this is the worst censorship of research and of clinical availability of a drug in the history of the world.
To hear that there was this sort of new dawn and this whole research pathway that could have opened up so much help for so many people. When you say things, it makes me pretty angry. Do you think people should be angry about this?
Oh, I think so. What's really bad at present is it, you know, we've now treated 50 people in our two trials of psilocybin for depression. And almost all of them have had a massive improvement. But most of them, the depression has creeping back because depression is an invidious, nasty disorder. So, well, for a while, I was the government's chief drugs advisor, and one of the things that I was fascinated by was how decisions were made about the relative harms of drugs in terms of putting them into the UK Misuse of Drugs Act, which classes drugs as A, B or C according to how harmful they are. And it was always seemed a little odd to me that drugs like LSD and psilocybin were in class A alongside drugs like crystal meth and crack cocaine. To cut a long story short, we started researching this the process of decision making using a proper, transparent and objective assessments. And after that, it came very clear that psychedelics were grossly had grossly exaggerated harms. And But also, of course, legal drugs like alcohol have their harms massively diminished. Now, when I started saying that publicly, well, that was the end of my career. The government didn't want to hear that because, you know, so many politicians drink and the drinks industry is so powerful as a lobby. You know, people want alcohol to be a tasty drink. They don't want it to be a drug. But of course, it is actually in Britain and probably in America and certainly in Europe, the most harmful and damaging drug of all. So the obstacles are really that because they're supposedly under the UN conventions and the British Misuse of Drugs Act, very dangerous drugs, which they're not, with a high abuse potential, they're anti-abuse, and no medical use, well, they've clearly got medical use, working with them is virtually impossible. You have to get a license, that can take a year, it costs £5,000. I had to have a special safe put into my office to hold my psilocybin and my LSD. So, well, hang on a sec, why can't I just put it in the pharmacy safe alongside the heroin and the fentanyl? And they said, well, because they're not Schedule One drugs. And I said, yeah, but if anyone breaks in, they're going to take the heroin and the fentanyl. They're not going to take the psychedelics, are they? No, Schedule One drugs, you have to have your own special safe. To have a camera there, making sure I'm not in there sniffing away at the mushroom juice once in a while. I mean, because we created the lies about their harm, we had to then create this whole barricade of regulations, this army of people protecting us from the dangers of these drugs. And so the whole thing is a complete fabrication based on the primary lie, which these were harmful drugs.
I think that's really important to stress just how important this research is right now, that we are in the midst of a profound global mental health crisis. There's something like 1 in 10 Americans will be taking an antidepressant, and they're increasingly getting less effective.
So there are two really strong arguments why we've got to completely reframe our attitude to these drugs. The first is what you've just mentioned, which is that the burden of mental illness is growing. Depression is now the largest health burden in the Western world. Health burden, not just mental health burden. That's the first thing. And the second reason is that traditional approaches have failed. There's virtually no drug company, no pharmaceutical company left in the world that is researching depression. Why? Because it's too difficult. They've tried for 30 years and they haven't been able to improve on the traditional antidepressants. So they've given up. So we've got to do something different. We can't wait, you know, for the pharmaceutical cavalry to come over the hill and rescue us, because it won't happen. So we've got to basically go back to a knowledge base, a scientific knowledge base, and restore the value, or restore these drugs to the previous value they have.
And I think it is important not to sort of scare people off pursuing antidepressants if they need it and if they're effective. But as a society, as a sort of scientific community especially, like, we need other options, right? And psychedelics seem to be opening up a potential very serious pathway.
No, absolutely. They're certainly the greatest innovation in psychiatry in my lifetime. I mean, I've been in psychiatry for 40 years now. And the other point about them is traditional antidepressants don't work for everyone. Mm. You know, the reason we started doing this work at all was because a lot of people don't get better on traditional antidepressants. So that group alone, if 30% of the depressed people don't respond to current treatments, that's a lot of people. So even that subgroup would necessitate this kind of innovative research. But of course, there are also the other people who do get better on antidepressants, who don't like the side effects, and the others who might actually just want to have some choice in the kind of treatment they have.
So I know you've just said that you're a doctor and a scientist and you like the evidence base, but can I press you to depart from that and predict the future of it? Like, what does the psychedelic future look like?
Well, I'm pretty confident that if the next tranche of trials comes out as well as the previous tranche, there will be unquestionable, you know, indubitably the case that psychedelics are powerful medicine for a range of psychiatric disorders. I think they will be a significant part of the future of psychiatry. And I think it's, unless there's some bizarre kind of right-wing swing against them, you know, with the war on drugs rising again, I cannot see how they cannot be accepted into medicine within a decade and be widely used.